is Sally Morgan, physical therapist, craniosacral therapist, and Tellington Teeth Touch practitioner for animals and people. And this is Tristan, he's a corgi, and we're here for an episode of Conversations with a Corgi. And we are starting really late today because I had a meeting this morning at 7:30 that I completely forgot about until it was 7 this morning. So we could not do Conversations with a Corgi at our usual time. So it's been kind of a whirlwind day, and I am just getting home now to do this talk. So what we're going to start talking about now is emotion code, which is another kind of work I do. But before we get too far down the road with emotion code, we need to understand something called kinesiology. And that is spelled K-I-N-E-S-I-O-L-O-G-Y, kinesiology. This was a class I had in PT school, but it's a lot of other things too. So the basic definition of kinesiology is that it's the study of the mechanics of body movements. You know, how you move your body. Are you walking equally on two legs? Are you putting more weight on one side than the other? Do you have an equal sway in your hips? How do you move? But there's also another popular kind of kinesiology now where you use muscle testing to discover imbalances in a body's structure, emotional, chemical, any kind of situation going on in the body you can access by muscle testing. Now, when I was in PT school, our kinesiology book was this big giant thing called Muscles, Testing, and Function. I'm losing my corgi because my lap is slippery today. And in this book, we learn how to isolate every single muscle in the body, and then you let me find a good picture for you. See how this person is laying down and they have their arm bent, and then they're going to push out into this hand. And we're going to see how strong they are when they do that. And we're isolating the muscle, the deltoid up in the shoulder when they do that, or some of the other muscles in the arm or in the rotator cuff. And if you've ever had a visit with a physical therapy, you will be subjected to muscle testing in every direction, because this is something that they consider measurable, and it is a matter of opinion. You know, if I'm pushing my arm out this way as strongly as I can, and I'm a 90-pound little ancient person, it's going to be a lot weaker than a bodybuilder pushing out. So you have to decide, as the tester, are you going to call what that goes up to a number 5? Is it a 5? If it's as strong as that little 90-pound person can push, and a person who's a bodybuilder can push a 5 so hard that they're going to knock me down. But you encourage the person to make a maximal effort when they're doing this, which is really hard on the person doing the testing if you're doing this all day long. And over the years, any PT, hi Pat, will find what we call quick and dirty ways to quickly test things without having to do the absolute protocol, because so many elderly people, or somebody who just had a knee replacement, they can't really push against you, and you don't really want them to. And a lot of people that have possibly had a knee replacement or shoulder work have injured themselves because they are weekend athletes or something, and when you ask them to push against you, they might push really hard and ruin some of the surgery that they've just had. So it's constantly a tightrope walk, trying to figure out what is the strength of that muscle and how strong is their maximum and where is it at right now. And sometimes you can't test because they've just had a surgical procedure. So that's what kinesiology is in physical therapy, is learning how to test the muscles. You have to learn 100 ways to move a person around, laying down, like on their stomach with their knee bent or their knee straight. It changes which muscles they're using, so you get different strength tests on that. And it is a pretty consistent way, as what they call inter-rater reliability, which is meaning, if I test a 5 today, I'm going to test a 5 every day next week, and next week, and next weekend, and 7 years from now. What I think is a 5 will always be a 5. What I think is a 5 might be different from the guy next to me. So that reliability is not nearly as good. So anyway, that's what that kind of muscle testing is. There's another kind of muscle testing that you might have had at your chiropractor or your naturopath or in a T-Touch class. We do a kind of kinesiology as well. And this kind of kinesiology is the kind where you use muscle testing to see what's going on in the person's structure or their emotions or the energy of their body to see what their body needs or wants. So this is the hallmark of what emotion code is based on, is doing a lot of muscle tests. So for instance, when I went to my naturopath, and you might have done this with your chiropractor, you hold out an arm like this, and he silently asks himself, or sometimes out loud, hold on, Tristan, he'll say, does Sally need a calcium supplement? And then he'll push on my arm, and if it's strong, that means yes, I do, and if it goes down, that means no, I don't. And sometimes they'll even ask, you know, show me yes, show me no. And sometimes they won't even tell you what it is. They'll hold the thing in their hand and see if you're strong when you're holding that one. And this is the best way to do it, because then your left brain isn't saying, oh yeah, calcium, that would be good. You know, it's got to be more intuitive, more like, how do I feel about this thing? And then you get a more objective kind of an answer. In Tellington Tea Touch work, we do kinesiology as a way to communicate with our animals and find out what some of their needs are when we're confused. And we do this, I can't do it here because I can't show you my whole self on this phone that is recording me, but you're standing up and you ask yourself which direction is yes in your sway. So you'll be swaying front and back in your normal person just standing there. Some people go side to side very, very occasionally. One in a thousand maybe will sway side to side. So you'll ask which way is yes, and most people fall forward for yes and backwards for no. But we always check, because it's not always that way for everybody. And some people are really uncomfortable with this and they can't do it, or they don't feel like it's a valid assessment, so they won't do it. So in T-Touch classes, we might use this to ask yes or no questions to the dog. Do you feel like you have worms in your body and that's causing your problem? And that's kind of a complicated question. So we'd have to go back, you know, do you think you have worms? And get a yes or a no. And you are channeling what the dog is asking. There isn't a good way to actually do a muscle test on a dog. I have done that on occasion with animals I know well, certainly with some horses I have, with leaning into their shoulders or asking them to hold a leg. And then if they get practiced at it, you really literally can do this on an animal. But frankly, I don't think anyone else can do it. It's really hard. You have to have a relationship with the animal. So the way we do it with animals, especially in emotion code work, you'd be holding out your arm and, you know, the person's coming to you with their pet. So they have a hand on the pet and you ask them to say their name. So they might say, my name is Mary. My name is Mary. And their arm is strong. Then you ask them to say their pet's name. My name is Fluffy. My name is Fluffy. And until it's strong, when they're saying Fluffy, they are not really in Fluffy. They're still in their own mind. So when they're resisting and you're saying, my name is Fluffy, they are, and they're holding it strongly, that's when you can start to ask Fluffy questions. Like, Fluffy, do you like liver? Yes. Fluffy, do you want to eat cornflakes? No. So we do this with emotion code to ask specific questions related to trapped emotions in the body. What is out in the yard today, Biscuit? You can actually see the yard today because the sun is out. and so we use muscle testing that way. Now there's other ways that you can do it. I do 90% of my emotion code work long distance. So I have hurt shoulders too. So I am really not a good person for my naturopath to be asking yes or no questions with my arm held out, because I can't resist anything. They're all weak. And he's a big, strong man, so he can totally flatten my arm anytime. So I do another way to do muscle testing, which is interlacing your fingers like this. Make a little infinity thing, like those chains you make at Christmas time. And you can ask yourself yes and no questions this way. Like, you know, is my name Sally? Yes. And I can't break that bond. Is my name Marjorie? No. And, you know, I really can't hold it when I'm thinking I am Marjorie, because I'm not. But if I am working with, let's say, Fluffy, and he lives in Kansas, I will do this until it's strong. I am Fluffy. My name is Fluffy. My name is Fluffy. My name is Fluffy. My name is Fluffy. And then I'll ask Fluffy questions. Does Fluffy need more water? Yes. And so I can work with Fluffy physically long distance that way. But with the emotion code work, We're specifically asking him ideas about his emotions. And we'll talk more specifically about emotion code and how that works another day. But basically, you have a little grid, and you ask them if their trapped emotion is in column A or B, and then you go down the list on each side of that to get to the specific emotion. And then you can ask them additional questions about how that trapped emotion got stuck in their body, how old they were, and some things like that. It is not animal communication. It is very different from animal communication. And you can do a lot of work with emotion code that can be really helpful. I've done emotion code with lots of dogs and horses and a few people, because I mostly do it with animals. And we have done really good work seeing a shift in an animal's behavior. For instance, if they don't like another pet in the house, that can be something where emotion code is really effective. Or I have a horse who had an issue with another horse in the pasture. They had a big fight on a trail ride or something, and they don't like each other at all. And the owner of the horse, that my client actually, feels like that horse has huge issues with the other horse. And in fact, when we did the emotion code, he's so confident, he doesn't have a big issue with the other horse, but his owner still does. So that's an interesting thing to find out, because then we can work with her and help her and work with him to get better so that he's not using those trapped emotions in his body to trap in physical things related to the injuries he had from the other horse. So most people who ask me to do emotion code with their dogs usually have a dog that is having some kind of behavior problem in the house, like chewing up the furniture, not getting along with the cat. Maybe they have a rescue dog and he just seems really subdued and they don't know why. And so I'll do emotion code for them. I did emotion code on all 10 of my sister's dogs that she had at the time, and they're all rescues. She doesn't even really know much about them from up till like 6 years of age. And so it was really interesting finding out what their trapped emotions were and trying to figure out what could have happened in their lives at that point. And there was one dog that she had, and I think I did two or three sessions with this dog, and it kept coming up to this some issues around age like 6 or something. My sister had had this one since the dog was like 4, and she just couldn't figure out what had happened to try to help the dog. And of course, during the work, the dog releases the trapped emotions anyway, so the dog's already feeling better. But it took about 2 months of, you know, questions, doing more work until we figured out what had happened. I think there was a new dog that came to the house then, and that dog felt like their place was disrupted in the pack, and it triggered a lot of emotions from their early puppyhood. And so the dog had had like what was a pretty big problem for the dog, but nobody noticed that it was a big problem. The dog seemed fine, you know, she was getting along with everybody. So stuff like emotional issues like that, that you can just tell your dog's not the same, but not really anything specific, emotion code can be really useful for that. And we do it through kinesiology this way. And even if I have the client at my house with their pet, or if I'm at the barn with a person and their horse, I don't do it with them having their arm on the horse and an arm out like this, because I still feel like I'm getting the person's input as well as the horse's, which can be really useful. I mean, certainly a lot of, like in that case, that person's emotions, feeling like their horse is really traumatized by the other horse, was affecting her horse, even though he wasn't as traumatized emotionally by the other horse. So there is a connection, but I like to keep that teased out when I'm working with someone to do the best benefit for them. So understanding how the horse felt and then doing a separate session for the person got to the bottom of what the real issue was, and I was able to more effectively resolve it. So I hardly ever have the person put their hand on the pet and muscle test them from here. I almost always, even if they're in the room with the pet, I'll just have them sit with the pet like I am with Tristan now. You are loving the backyard. And I will just quietly not even say the questions I'm asking out loud and just ask my fingers, you know, yes or no questions. Is it this one? Is it this emotion? Is it that emotion? And we'll talk more about that tomorrow. So it's important to understand how muscle testing works. Now, a lot of people believe that muscle testing is a bunch of hooey and that, you know, it's not really true. Like, I can resist. If I am holding something in my hand that is not benefiting me, and the naturopath is asking me, does Sally need this supplement? People believe that you are able to hold your arm so strongly, even if you don't need it, that you can resist the person. And personally, that has never been the case for me. And I have tested lots of people, and that has never been the case for them. So I really physically cannot make it any stronger when I'm purposely trying to say that something's good for me when it might not be. I can't do it. And I don't think anyone really can. So there has been a lot of people that don't trust muscle testing. And certainly if you're someone like me, and let's face it, there's a lot of us like me who have shoulder problems and issues with their neck, having someone resist with their arm out like this is kind of unfair. And so, yeah, it might not be effective because you can't resist anything. But that swaying front to back you can use, or this one you can use. And also using a pendulum gets the same thing. And if I don't trust my muscle test, I will get a pendulum and hold it. I can just use my cord here and ask it to spin yes, which it will do. I'm going to make it do it. And then I can ask it to spin no, and it will go the other way. And then I can ask the pendulum yes and no questions. So sometimes I'll do that to verify what I'm getting with muscle testing, particularly if it's related to myself, like should I go to this expo or something? Or, you know, should I get this dog or that one? Is it time to get a new dog even? Those kinds of questions you can be really like not clear on. So I can use a pendulum in that case, or I can muscle test myself. We're not getting a new dog right now, Biscuit. You're okay. Where are you hiding? So those are some of the basics of muscle testing. And if you look up emotion code online, there are lots and lots of demos of the people that develop the work showing people on stage, then they're asking them questions. And you know, you don't dialogue with the person like, oh, let's say you have despair from age 5. We don't say, what happened to you at age 5? Do you want to talk about it? It's not that kind of therapy. It just comes up and you kind of go, as the person having the work done. And then we use magnets to clear the governing meridian. And that gets rid of that trapped emotion. So it's just bringing it into your consciousness, but then it removes it. And so there might be some skeptical people about that too, but I have found it to be tremendously effective. And with animals in particular, it's tremendously effective because they are not trying to maintain an illness for the most part. They are not trying to not function at their maximum like some people are. I had a woman who purposely, she even flat out told me one day, I can't get better because my husband is not nice to me unless I'm sick. And I said, okay then, I know what we're going to be doing in therapy. We're going to help you function as best you can, but you are not going to get better. And oh, we had a great rapport. I saw that lady for years off and on, and it worked out really well. So, you know, you don't always go in there with the intention to heal. As I said, our intention is to facilitate a shift and to remember your potential for perfection, whatever that perfection may be. So that's a little overview of muscle testing. Certainly the physical therapy kind of muscle testing is really just challenging a muscle that's isolated by positioning the body a certain way. For instance, with your finger, you know, if I'm pushing it down this way, I'm testing these muscles. If I'm pushing the finger to the side, I'm testing muscles on one side or the other side. And I'm just seeing if I can hold it. I'm not even thinking anything like, do I like pickles? I'm just moving the finger and seeing how much it can resist. But when we're asking questions, then you are holding a thought or holding a product in your hand or a food product, like, am I allergic to almonds? Holding the almonds. And, you know, allergic is a big word. You might have to bring that down. Does it affect me in a bad way if I eat almonds versus are almonds good for me? Or, you know, do almonds affect my digestive system? Do almonds give me a good quality nutrition? So you have to really refine the question. And that is a big part of doing emotion code work and a big part of doing any kind of kinesiology testing as we do in T-Touch when you're talking to the animal, because the question can't be too big and it can't be one that can have a lot of answers. It has to be simple yes and no. Like, are parasites making you sick? Well, there might be parasites, but they might not be making you sick. So you're not getting a clear answer there. Do you have parasites? Well, we all have parasites. You know, we all have bacteria living on our bodies. So you have to be specific. Do you have hookworms? That's specific, and the dog can tell you. And it's really their inner knowing that's telling you. It's not like the dog saying, I have a pain here. And it's like when I had hookworms when I was a puppy. I think that's right. I think I do have hookworms. No, it's coming from their intuitive inner knowing. And it's not 100% accurate, but it is pretty darn close. And it can be a really useful thing for you to learn muscle testing to interact with your pet, to ask them questions. It can be really good. You can ask them questions about which treats they like. You can ask them questions about the other dog in the house. Do you mind sharing your bed with the cat? Yes or no? And if they do, then do you want a new bed? Sure. Okay. Where do you, well, you can't even say, where do you want your new bed? Do you want your new bed next to the cat? No. Do you want your new bed next to my bed? Yes. So it's a pretty good way to get some basic stuff with your dog. And I always kind of take it with a grain of salt and do other things to see. And I do what my answers are, like put the dog's bed next to my bed and see if he uses it, if he said that's where he wants it. And so you can, test out your theories. So that's just a quick overview of muscle testing or kinesiology to ask your dog questions or to actually test the strength of a muscle. But tomorrow, and I'm going to the Cape tomorrow and I'll be there all weekend, but as we and there's dog shows and parades and stuff I have to go to, so I don't know when I will be doing my next talk. But we will try to continue our talks about emotion code over the weekend, but we might be just talking about how wonderful it is to be in Provincetown and all the great fun things that we have going on there. And they've moved the dog show, so I don't even know if I'll have a good connection to do a Facebook Live from the show, which is on Sunday. But are certainly a few more episodes along the way. We'll be talking more about emotion code, and I'll be showing you the little chart that we use and talking to you about some of the animals I've worked with so that you can understand how that works. And I do it long distance, and I do not need to be in the room with the animal to do it, neither does most people who do this work. And there's a few people around the world that do this with animals. I got hooked on it from a friend of mine in Hawaii. So that's a little bit about muscle testing. That's all we're going to do today. Tristan wants to go out in the yard, I think. He's been looking out there for the whole time we've been talking. So I will see you again tomorrow, Saturday or Sunday, and or all of them for another episode of Conversations with a Corgi. Like I said, I'm trying to get out pretty early on the road tomorrow so that I can get to P-Town in time for something is at 3 o'clock at the library, a reading. And I want to be able to go to that to support other authors because that's really important to me. So we will try to do that. And I don't know what time we'll be leaving here in the morning, but we'll see. So thanks for joining us today for another Conversations with a Corgi where we talked about kinesiology. And we will be back tomorrow, Saturday, Sunday at some point, talking about kinesiology, emotion code, and or the fun times at the Pet Weekend in Provincetown. Yeah, we will have a good time, Pat. Thanks for joining us. Have a great day. Oh, we forgot the corgi music again, Biscuit. You got to keep me on the straight and narrow here, Bis. I often miss that. That's his signal to get a treat. I can't ever play this on my flute live, or he will think it's time to have a snack. Do you want a snack? Yes, and you can go out too. Get some new household members from the Corgi auction, so maybe tomorrow we'll do a quick introduction to them. So we'll see you then. Have a great day.